New emails reveal that the Trump appointees actually celebrated the fact that they made the CDC suppress COVID data last year. So what do we have here? It ain't just a Cuomo story, right?
Right.
You know, we thought, okay, well, you know, when we saw Andrew Cuomo hustling the system, lying about 10,000 claims so he could look like a hero, everybody went after Cuomo. But they knew that this was happening. They knew that this, in the background, Trump was doing the same thing, right?
Yeah, and the House of Representatives now has their hands on emails from the Department of Health and Human Services where they're actually talking about not just suppressing all of the data, but they were very specific. They wanted to downplay all of the data showing how infectious COVID could be for children,
right?
Because they were wanting to reopen schools as quickly as possible. And people have to understand too, this is not just from the early days of the pandemic. This is as recently as last September and October, where these emails come out where they say, hey, we got them to change the numbers. Yippee,
exactly.
Is what they wrote in the email.
Yippee. Those were their exact words.
Yes.
Yippee. We succeeded in lying to the American public. You know, okay, so the dynamics were you had the Democrats wanting to shut down the economy. No question. That's what they wanted to do. They knew that would help them in the presidential race. You had Trump who says, I want a robust economy. I want everything open. And I want the appearance that everything's good. But when you have the CDC being affected, when you have the CDC that is under pressure to lie to the American public about something that is absolutely life-threatening, potentially to your children, that gets pretty serious. That's kind of about 30 seconds. That's kind of over the top, isn't it?
It is, absolutely. This is an agency that is supposed to be guided by science and science alone. It's not left. It's not right. It's simply based on facts and statistics. But we know that this organization has, at least up to this point, been corrupted. And it does call into question, even though we have a new administration, Are we still getting accurate information? What is happening behind the scenes? I think there's a lot more to this that we still need to learn.
Well, we're seeing on the border, we're not getting the information here, so you can conclude, are we getting information about this? I mean, you know, we have to be honest about what's going on around us. I would love to wear blinders and not have to say any of this stuff, wouldn't you?
It would be great.
Farron Cousins, the best progressive voice on the net, television, anywhere. Thank you for joining me.
Okay? Thank you.
Changes made to Title IX under former Education Secretary Betsy DeVos, well, they've alarmed critics who say that students are now discouraged from filing sexual harassment claims. Now many are pressuring Biden's administration to hit undo on this. Joining me to talk about this is attorney Alexander Brodsky. Alexander, let me ask you, when people look at this law, this legislation, they don't even see the most important part of it, do they? They don't understand what the impact is on violence against people in these settings, do they? What's your take?
I think that's absolutely right. You know, I'll say that when I was a student, I thought that Title IX was a law that just had to do with women's sports. But Title IX prohibits all kinds of sex discrimination in schools and has for decades required that schools from, you know, kindergarten to graduate school address sexual harassment that students experience. Because if you're being sexually harassed in school, you can't learn. And Betsy DeVos, Trump's Secretary of Education, created new rules for Title IX that turned a sex discrimination law into a weapon against survivors of sexual harassment. She limited what kinds of sexual harm schools are required to address, and she lowered the bar for what adults have to do when a student turns to them for help.
Well, hasn't she really shifted the burden here? I mean, isn't that what it is? You're making a claim. There's been abuse involved. You have a very clear claim, but she has shifted the burden to the person who's the victim now, hasn't she?
What I think that she's really done is she's lowered the burden on schools. So what she's done is said that there are fewer kinds of sexual harms that schools have to respond to. And that when they get that complaint from a child, rather than acting in a way that is prompt and effective, which is what administrations required, both Democratic and Republican administrations required for decades before, now all a school has to do is not be, quote, clearly unreasonable. And what that essentially does is it gives schools a incentive to avoid learning about sexual harassment. And then it basically says, so long as they do something when a student reports, that's going to be enough. They're going to be off the hook. And one of the things that really saddens me is that students used to be able to turn to the Department of Education for help if they felt like their school had mistreated them when they had filed a complaint of sexual harassment. But now, even though we have a new administration, which I think it's clear cares more about student survivors, Betsy DeVos's legacy continues to tie this department's hands because her rules are binding. And so even if everyone at the Department of Education agrees that a school hasn't done enough to support a student survivor, they have to follow Betsy DeVos's rules and let the school off the hook.
Yeah, what I found incredible about this is everything you're saying is kind of hidden in here, isn't it? If somebody doesn't understand the law, they look at this and say, looks pretty innocuous, till you start understanding what the ramifications are. What I love about your organization, and that's why I love to have you on this show, you're actually litigating a Title IX case brought forward by high school students in California. Your organization does that all the time. Thank you for that. Bring us up to speed on that case, if you would.
Sure. So Public Justice represents a organization of high school students in California who are suing the Department of Education. And the goal is to get a federal court to strike down what we see as the most damaging parts of the rule. And I have to say, I have loved working on this suit because we represent this organization, the Women's Student Union in Berkeley, and they are made up of young students, they're high schoolers, they're just trying to learn, and they are taking on the ultimate Goliath, which is their federal government, and saying, hey, you need to protect us just as you protected students for decades before. And one of the things that we're also excited about with this lawsuit is that it's the first one to focus on how DeVos's rules impact K-12 students. So a lot of public debate about sexual assault, sexual harassment in schools focuses on colleges and universities. And it's certainly true that there's far too much violence and in higher education, and that schools are often not doing enough. But I have to tell you, K-12 schools, when we're talking about true children, those schools are years behind colleges and universities. A lot of them don't even think that they have to do anything when a student turns to them for help. And so we're really glad that this lawsuit can shine a spotlight on the specific impact of these regulations on younger students who, in truth, are much more reliant on their adults in their lives, adults in schools, to do right by them.
Well, we're out of time, but I bet you would agree with me that the Biden administration, they need to take action to amend the changes that are made this Title IX. They need to do it now. Anyway, thank you for joining me. Thank you for being in that fight, and I hope you'll come back.
Thanks for having me.